Hi, I'm Chris Valentin from Bethel Church in Redding, California. And I have my wife here, Kathy, of 46 years.
Hi.
This is Cole and Kate. They actually lead our Moral Revolution team. And I thought it'd be really important for us to make some clarifying comments about some of the videos, especially that came out on TikTok over a half hour teaching I did, that it's very easy to see why people would be very concerned. There's so many pastors and ministers falling sexually. And that's just been going on for years and years. So when people see conversations around sexuality and they see a man talking about women, it's very easy for them to have, what's he doing? And wow, why did he say that stuff? And then we have the whole Me Too movement, which I've been very excited about because I really think it is time for, women to stand up and say, hey, you know what? You're not going to shame me into doing this movie. I don't have to sleep with you to get to a place. And we've been very excited about the Me Too movement.
Yeah.
Obviously there's been a few parts where we're like, that was probably not the best, but with the fact that we're seeing morality now, even in Hollywood and in the business world. And, we've been, I wrote a book about empowering women called Fashion to Reign. So it's been pretty exciting, but it also has a side effect in that, are you shaming women and are you bringing that, that whole old religious kind of shame into the whole world of sexuality. So we want to have an open conversation about that, try to answer some of those questions. We know that there's, some people just hate you because they hate you. There's no way to solve that. But, many years ago, we had a youth group and it was started with the Trinity County Probation Department. And actually it started with a 6-week class. And what they were doing is they had all these kids that had violated their probation, their juveniles, and they basically made a rule that said, hey, your parents have to come to parent training because they trace back the kids' behavior to their families. And so the probation officer said, the head of probation, who was also somebody I knew, he said, we're going to have a 6-week class on parenting, and we're going to do it 2 days a week. Would you like to do something with the kids? Now, we're a probation department, so we know that you love kids. I used to be a youth pastor at the time. I was previously a youth pastor before this. He said, would you do something with the kids 2 days a week? You can't. And my friend said, you can't bang them with the Bible. I'm like, yeah, that's great. So Kathy and I put together this plan. They gave us this old gym. We swept it out. It was a lot of fun, actually. Hadn't been used in many, many years. It was like dirt and spider webs. And
leaked.
It was winter time. It would just leak terribly. So we got this whole plan. Our family worked on the gym for a couple of weeks, got it ready. And Kathy, there was a basketball net, a volleyball net in there and a basketball court. So on one side, she set up volleyball. Our kids were young then. I set up basketball and we ended up and started with 36 kids. And these were all kids on probation. So what we learned, so we started out 6 weeks, we ended up there 5 years, that group grew. We probably had 150 kids who rotated through. We had an average of about 100 kids a night.
Oh.
Different ages too, young, really young to older college age.
Yeah. Wow. We started out with everybody under 18, of course, because they were juveniles. But as soon as the 6 weeks was over and we opened the door to the kids, to whoever, we suddenly had, wow, all these kids. And just to give you an idea of the climate, I broke up 5 fist fights the first night. So, we're talking about knives and people bringing guns, drug deals. This is the atmosphere. And that we were, and it was 2 of us. So with, you can imagine 100 kids. So one of the stories that's on TikTok that I told, there was a much longer story than, and by the way, the TikTok video came from a half hour video. It was actually an hour and 20 minute teaching that was shortened to a half an hour that was shortened to TikTok. So you can imagine what that looked like,
yeah.
Obviously. But it was a story about the very first night of the, it was the story of the very first night. And we had so many kids that we had like 10 kids on each basketball team. The volleyball court was full because we're trying to like, how do you keep this many kids busy?
We used to call it jungle ball.
We call it jungle ball. And, and one of the, we have girls and guys all on, mixed teams are playing basketball, quote, basketball. It's not real basketball. And, you know, this girl, this gal who's a pretty good basketball player, she's running down the court and the guys are, you know, they're grabbing her breasts and they're pulling on her. And I'm like, whoa, whoa, whoa. You know, and so we spent the night like, hey, that's a foul on another level. Like, so, and what we did is we played for an hour, then we have a half hour teaching, and then we play, finish with another hour. So that very first night, the Lord gave me this whole teaching. It's in the book, More Revolution, if you ever want to read it, about this ring. And it's a story about, really about nobility and purity and the restoration of virginity. And obviously it fit perfect with the people we have, you know? And so, you know, I'm telling this story about God's idea of virginity. And of course, it's like you can't tell it out of the Bible. So we're telling the story and about how, you know, God has created us to have sex inside of marriage. And it came out of this and was in this fiction story that I made up, and about the restoration of that. And when we get to the climax of the night where this guy, you know, fights for and works for this ring, which in the end turns out to be a parable. We call it the parable of the ring, the restoration of virginity. The girl who was, I told the story of, you know, getting grabbed and the point of that part of that story was that she was, you know, raised in a drug home. She didn't have a dad, and this was all normal. Like, this is the way they behaved. She wasn't trying to stop them from doing that. It was like a, you know, a big joke and funny. And I'm like, this is not how we treat women. And women, this is not how we let men treat us. When we got to the end of that story, half an hour story, and the climax of that story is that God actually created you to live your sexuality out in covenant, because the world perverts sex.
Yeah.
The religion shames it, but the kingdom celebrates it. God's the one who created sex. It was his idea.
Yeah.
So, you know, to not celebrate sex in the right culture, I mean, in the right circumstance, is crazy. And that girl, that specific girl who, you know, my first hour with her, I shared with you. She said, no one effing ever told me about this, in tears. And that was one of the motivations for us staying with those kids for 5 years. We didn't get paid for it. We won 2 community awards. We saw so many kids come to Christ.
Amazing thing about that particular moment was after one of the girls had shared that, one of the guys said, nobody's ever sat me down. Nobody's ever told me about this. Nobody's ever told me about the sanctity of virginity and why that's so important.
Of course, he didn't say sanctity, but there was some Egyptian language in there. Yeah. You know,
we're not going to use.
But we had 36 kids weeping in the gym that night, not because they were being shamed, but because they were actually for the first time being envisioned, like, this is why I have a sex drive. Years before, I'm supposed to have sex inside of marriage. And it wasn't the old 90s religion, like, let's shame people into, it was the opposite of that. It was like, this is a vision for why God said no, because God's the one who created sex, da, da, da. And it was beautiful.
They were shown a different standard to adhere to.
Wow.
And they never just had experienced anything like that before. They didn't have parents or grandparents or uncles or aunts that stepped in to say, hey, you're worth more than this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we spent the next, as soon as the 6 weeks was over, because we couldn't use the Bible, you know, we started building on that. Like, how do you actually love yourself? Mm-hmm. And if you respect yourself, how do you behave? How do you dress, both men and women? How do you look at, you know, guys, you know, that's God's daughter. Your job is to, if you would date her, your job is to leave her better than you took her, because she may not be your wife. She may be someone else's wife. And so we spent a lot of time teaching men, how do you manage your eye gate? Women, how do you manage your sex drive? And you know, it was never, on the video, it sounds like, we made it the woman's fault because the man is sexualizing her. nothing could be further from the truth.
Yeah.
It was really great on the basketball court. You know, we'd have new people come every single week. There'd be somebody new there. There'd be handfuls of people. And the guys that were new would try to do what they did before when the gym first opened. Wow. And it was really awesome.
Yeah.
Because you'd see the guys that had been there for a while running beside them, putting their hand on the shoulder saying, "We don't do that in here." Yeah. Or "We don't talk like that in here."
Yeah. Yeah.
And they were policing themselves. They were
taking ownership.
Yeah.
They were. That's great.
And
treating women with respect, mm-hmm. treating men with respect, teaching men and women how to be noble, not how to be religious, not how to be sexual prudes, but how to be, you know, how to actually manage yourself towards it. So that story, you know, when it gets cut into little pieces can sound pretty crazy. And in fact, you know, you guys heard the TikTok video and like, that's not even the story.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, whoa, like he was letting, you know, men grab her, like, whoa, whoa, whoa.
Yeah.
How did that even get interpreted even from the short version? It was polar opposite of that. So yeah, that's really a big part of our heart is to love people. You know, there's a principle called the principle first mention. Mm-hmm. And that's the principle first mention says that we were created this way. The first time I hear about a subject, it doesn't just become like information. It becomes the way I see that subject. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about sexuality because that's what we're talking about right now, but it works in every subject. If my parents don't talk to me about sexuality until I'm 15, but Johnny told me at 12 about pornography, the challenge is that Johnny didn't just tell me about pornography. He gave me the lens in which I will view that subject.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I will either reject. So from what Johnny taught me about pornography, when my parents teach me about sexuality from a noble perspective, it's going to be in my mind to reject what they said because what Johnny taught me isn't just instruction. It's a foundation for the way I will see that subject.
Exactly.
So part of the challenge we have as parents and part of the reason why I think it's important for fathers and mothers to get involved and part of the reason why it's important for fathers to talk about sexuality to their daughters and mothers to talk about sexuality to their sons and for this to be a fathering, mothering movement and not just like, well, mom snuck me over in the corner. It, you know, one of the things we're trying to do is we're trying to break shame off of people around the subject of sexuality.
Yeah.
So for example, we teach parents, like when you have a little child and they're 2 years old and they're touching their vagina or touching their penis and you're like, don't do that. Like, but it's okay that they touch their tongue. Yeah. They touch their ears. You know, they're learning their parts of their body probably a little earlier than, you know, 2 years old. It's what you did is you just said there's shame attached to sex. Like, hey, these are your ears. These are your nose. This is your mouth. That's your dinky. That's all ways that religious spirit of shame seeps in. Oh, daddy can't talk to his daughter about sexuality because there's shame attached to it. Like, it's a secret thing that we should whisper someplace in the closet. We should get the daughters off to the side and, okay, let me tell you. Okay, when you get like that's not the way it works. Like if you read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, God talks about sex. This is not a fathers talk to sons, moms talk to. Yes, that's true, and there are parts of that that are true, but because we're breaking shame off of things, and because this is a spiritual and biological fact that we work through together. Fathers and mothers in a healthy family, in a healthy pastoral family, we both should have input into the way that our sexuality works.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we engage in those conversations with our kids. You know, if Caleb's wanting to talk to mom, he talks to mom. If he wants to talk to me, you know, the kids, I mean, really children, it depends on the topic even.
Totally.
Yeah. Right? Like, he'll talk to Kate about certain things, our boys will, and they'll want to talk to me about different. And we don't say, no, that's mom's conversation or dad's. We want to lean into it. I think one thing I think could be good to jump into, Chris and Kath, is if you guys wanted that, I think we should address, because there's a constant narrative of purity culture.
Yeah.
And there's a big pushback on virginity and feeling like, hey, if you're saying virginity is the goal, you're setting too high of a bar. Virginity's, you know, you can't make that the goal anymore. Obviously, part of one of the things you had talked about in the TikTok videos or in that message was, you know, hymen being restored. Right. And that's kind of what you're addressing is the ability to engage in this. But I think that it'd be really good for people to hear the heart on that, because it's so important for people to know, like, that is a value of ours. Now, it's not such a high value that we're shaming people that have not done that.
It's a vision thing, right? It's a God can do anything. Like, it doesn't matter how far you've fallen. You can't fall so far that he can't get you. You can't fall so fast that he can't catch you.
Yeah.
You couldn't sexually do something so wrong that he can't totally restore you.
Yeah.
That's exactly the point, right?
Right.
And because we are working with, you know, very broken kids, as we just pointed out, mm-hmm. like, how do I get this back? Like, no one taught me this. Yeah. No one ever taught me about virginity. No one ever taught me about purity. Mm-hmm. You know, these kids are having sex at 7, 8, 9 years old when we got to them. Like, and the question is, okay, you're teaching all this. Like, I've already done it wrong. I might as well just keep doing it. It's like, you better find a message that says God can restore anything.
Well, they need hope.
Yeah,
exactly. You
know, they need hope. They need something to be able to grab onto and see that there's hope in their life for change, for restoration.
I'll never forget this very first time we were with these two young people who got engaged, and then they were going to get married. And in the midst of all this, the gal who had grew up in a drug home, and at 15, her mother was sleeping with men for drugs, in exchange for drugs. Oh. And her story is that when she was 15 years old, two men came to the door, and her mother gave her the second man sexually, and then called her a whore and all these terrible things. Well, anyway, she gets saved in our youth group, and she's just this beautiful, wonderful woman. And then she gets engaged a couple years later to one of our young men who had been a Christian his whole life, that was not his pattern. He'd never slept with anyone. And about a year before the wedding, 8 months to a year before the wedding, she comes to Kathy and I, and she's like, I just want you to know that, you know, I lost my virginity. I've been with many men. And she's telling this whole story about this very broken story. And she's basically, my life is over, mm-hmm. you know, because he's kept himself. I haven't. And she's like, I am not, basically, let me say it in my language, I'm not worthy to be his wife. And we're like, you know, we're in the moment, right? Yeah. We're not like, we don't get to think through this. And like, come back tomorrow, we'll have a message for you, right? Yeah. You know, because
fast forward 20 years to figure out how this is going to land decades later.
Yeah. And people have lots of ideas about how you should do this. Like, yeah, it's a lot easier. You know, I started to tell you, I'll tell you the rest of that story in a minute, but we had people come in the gym to help us, right? Our Christian friends, we're talking about like with our non-Christian youth group, and the kids are like effing this and grabbing each other and doing all this stuff, right? This is especially the first year. And they would be like, we need to stop those kids from cussing. Stop the kids from cussing. That's your goal.
That's like, the hill you want to die on here?
I need you, you know, I let me take you down to their home and show you what they grew up with. And you tell me if your solution is to stop the kids from cussing. You know, it's like, so, you know, as Christians, we have this idea like what it should be like. But then you get thrown in the lion's den. And it's like, yeah, this stuff does
a lot different.
Not exactly the highest priority, you know. Yeah.
Totally.
You should keep those kids from touching each other. It's like, whoa. Yeah, it's not quite that easy.
You should keep those kids out of the gym around my child.
Oh yeah. We had parents come down and say, my kids can't come to the gym because of the kids you let in there. And then they're Christian kids and you know, they want to come play basketball. I'm like, you got a Christian youth group to take them there, you know?
Yeah.
Anyway, back to our story. So, you know, so she's with us and she's crying and she's like, I can't marry him because, you know, I'm basically, and so I say to her, like, this is not thought out, right? Not the theology isn't thought out.
Yeah.
You know, I've never heard anyone say this before. I'm like, and Kathy's with me. And I say, so she's, you know, weeping and saying, you know, I'm not worried to even marry him. Like, he's kept himself a virgin. I haven't. And da, da, da. You know, we know her story really well. And I say to her, I'm going to pray for you right now. And God's going to restore your virginity. Kathy looks over at me like, oh, Lord Jesus, please let this happen. So she, and she looks at me and she says, what did you say? I said, I'm going to, you know, now I'm like totally like freaking terrified. Out inside. I'm terrified.
Yeah.
Standing bold.
You know how you're like on the outside, you're bold, but the inside you're like,
yep.
Like my heart is pounding. And I say, I try to make it like more bold. I'm going to pray for you right now. And God's going to restore your virginity. She said, okay. So, you know, so we lay hands on her and we pray for her, right? And then she goes through and does get married. And 9 months later, she gets married. They go on a honeymoon. We were part of the wedding, you know, laying hands on them, pray for her. We didn't actually marry them, but we were part of the ceremony. And 3 days later, she calls me and she says, she calls me dad. She's like, dad, she's crying. I'm like, yeah. She goes, remember when you and mom prayed for me? I'm like, yeah. She's like, to restore my virginity. Oh, yeah, I remember that. She's like, well, the Lord restored my hymen. This is the girl who had, you know, been with me.
Was that even what was in your head when you said that?
No, of course not.
Right. Like, you're not even thinking that.
No, I'm thinking, no, never.
Emotional restoration, mental restoration, her to feel.
Soul ties broken.
Sense of
strength and purity.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
So she said, the Lord restored my hymen and da-da-da-da-da. I'm like, okay. Not something you're usually going to tell your youth pastor.
Yeah, right.
And so that, you know, a beautiful story. Well, years later, now fast forward 5 years or 7 years, and I'm doing this talk on virginity, on sexuality. And at the end of it, I'm giving this like, hey, God can, and I'm telling what we call her Grace. It's not a real name. I'm telling Grace's story as a, because culture's like, okay, I've already blown it. Now what do I do? And I'm telling Grace's story about the restoration of virginity, right? And mention at the end, like even God restored her physically. You know, I don't think I said the word hymen in those days. Yeah. God restored
her physically. Now we say hymen all the time, yeah, 20 years later. Yeah. Didn't start out that
way. Exactly. And anyway, the short story is, so we tell the story, right? There's like 1,000 people. It's in this conference. And within probably that year, within a year, I get like 20 or 25 private messages. The Lord restored my hymen. Mm-hmm. And all these stories. And I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, I don't know who's ever thinking that.
Yeah.
Right. You know, I'm thinking God's restoring, he's breaking soul ties, he's restoring your heart, he's restoring you back to purity. But for some reason, the early parts of this movement were God restoring women's hymens, like almost like a, I don't know, it's a prophetic declaration.
It's a testimony of God's love for those women.
Sure.
And I don't want to say it happened with, you know, who knows if it happened with everybody. Oh, you know, it's like, it's not very often, you know, when you say, hey, anybody got a miracle? You know, someone's like, yeah, that guy prayed for me and my arm got completely healed. You know, like someone else like, oh yeah, I was going to have a knee replacement, Lord. You know, it's like, how about you? Oh yeah, Lord, restore my hymen. It's like, you know, let's face it, guys, like that's not a testimony you normally hear, right?
Or that you normally share.
Right? Yeah. But so these are coming in private messages, by the way, and they're coming, you know, in emails and people getting on my private message on Facebook and Instagram. So, you know, I began to share those testimonies, you know, obviously no names or whatever.
Yeah.
Hey, God's restoring men and women. He's restoring them even physically. Wow. Like this is the miracle.
Yeah.
And the goal there is not to shame people who don't. It's to say to people who God, listen, no matter where you've come from, no matter what you've done, God has the power to restore you.
Yeah.
Now, whether or not he restores your hymen, I mean, you know, come on. I mean, I still think God's still done it in you.
Right.
But absolutely.
It's miraculous. And maybe it was just because it was the early part of our moral revolution movement that God felt necessary to restore people's, you know, physically like that. But that's the truth. And so I think it just brings a ton of hope to people.
Yeah. You know, I think it would be good too to talk about the balance there, because even with the story of her, you know, we were youth pastors for a long time.
Yeah.
You know that. Like we've been in so many moments where we're working through that. That's a bit of our story. I think the other thing that people have a hard time with right now is they would say the reason she felt shame is because of the church. The church is the reason that she felt so bad about having sex all those times, mm-hmm. and that you guys actually perpetuated that feeling in her. Mm-hmm. I think it'd be good for a second to just talk about that balance of, hey, how do we call people to the life that God has called us to without it feeling like we're highlighting all the reasons that you haven't done it the right way? You know, and you guys have done this for a very long time. I think that would be something really good to address, because we're not going to stop telling the truth of what we know the Bible has called us to. Our story is not that you guys aren't modern day, but we're newer than you. And we've been raised on computers and on the internet, right? Like, I remember computer class in eighth grade. Like, we've been raised in this culture, and we chose to wait. And I've never one day regretted that. I've never felt shame over that decision. That's the decision. Like, when we look back, mm-hmm. we're so thankful that we've made that. And there was never a point that we carried shame, but I think a lot of people do. A lot of people have, when we say we're preaching and we're teaching and we're saying, hey, we want to wait till we're married to have sex. Well, that makes me feel shameful. I'd love for you to share that balance, the messaging mm-hmm. of, hey, God has called us to health, and yet here's the space. And what does the balance of this conversation look like that could create some healing for people?
Yeah, I think two things. One is, first of all, what is the standard of the Bible? Because, you know, Jesus talked about not just the act of sex, but he talked about, especially to men, he talked about, if you look at a woman to even lust after her, you already committed adultery in your heart.
Yep.
Then he goes on to say, so if you're, this is in that whole verse, if your eye makes you stumble, pluck it out. If your hand makes,
so
you can
intense.
Imagine your youth pastor, your son going to his youth pastor and he comes back with one arm, you know, it's like,
I would probably kill the youth pastor.
Yeah, I think I would too. So, but what it does is it says that Jesus was passionate about purity. Mm-hmm. About sexual purity, that God wanted sex to be inside of covenant. That was God's plan from the very beginning.
And for those that don't know covenant, that's marriage.
Yeah, marriage.
Inside of marriage, right? There everybody might not have that language necessarily.
Yeah, that you're right. So God had planned for sex to be inside of marriage. One woman, one man in a partnership. Well, now we live in a culture where, you know, in the hookup culture, in fact, I was part of the sexual revolution culture, right, in the 60s. So it's like, well, we have many partners, and why, if I have a sex drive, why would a God give me a sex drive that wouldn't want me to have sex? You know, all these rationales. And so, you know, when we truth and compassion have to run together. I think that's the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's a fine line between shame and conviction.
Yeah, that's good.
So shame or condemnation says you're a liar. No, you lied, so you're a liar. And it connects my identity with my bad action, right?
Yep.
That's shame. That shame is from the dark side. Yeah. Like, it is a counterfeit conviction. And it often is outside in, right? It often says, you did that, you slept with that guy, therefore you are, okay, now I'm going to name you. A name that is going to become your identity, that shame. But conviction says, you're way too awesome to be acting like that.
Yeah.
You're acting below your nature.
Mm.
The challenge is that when you teach truth, you don't often get the opportunity to decide how people are going to process that, whether they're going to process it as shame and condemnation when they hear the truth, or are they going to process it as conviction and say, wow, I'm better than that. Like, I was made for more than that. Interesting. In the book of Nehemiah, there's a story of the fact that the people of God hadn't heard the word of God for like 40 years.
Yeah.
Nehemiah has the priests read the Bible to people from morning till night. This is the first time they've heard the Bible in 40 years. And their first response is they start to weep.
Mm.
They just break out crying because they never heard the standard of God.
Nobody ever told me this.
Nobody ever told us this.
Like,
is that exact thing. It was the same as the gym that night. When I read that Nehemiah, it's hard to not tear up knowing that that was the response of those kids who had never been exposed to the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Nehemiah sends the priests out into the congregation of thousands saying, stop weeping. And this is where that verse, the joy of the Lord is your strength. He says, stop weeping. Rejoice that you now know the truth, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Mm-hmm. And so they immediately take on shame. They're like, here's God's standard. Here's my life. I'm a retrograde. I'm a terrible person. And Nehemiah's like, no, you're not. Mm-hmm. That is not who you are. And so, you know, I think it's really difficult. One of the hardest things in this culture is to teach people truth.
Yeah.
It is difficult for people when you're actually teaching what Jesus said about purity.
It's tough.
And say, we're followers of Jesus. And then people are like, well, you're shaming me. Like, gosh, that would be the last thing I'd.
Yeah.
Like, shame is not a positive motivator. It doesn't lead you to change. What it does is it leads you to hide.
Yeah. Well, you know what might be good, Chris, if we maybe pause for a sec? I think it could be helpful, Kate, for you to kind of share a bit of your story right here. Because, you know, I think just for anybody that's watching, I think it's so critical that you hear the heart. You know, as Kate and I, we know Chris, we know Kathy, we watched the stuff that was on the internet. I thought, man, this is a really poor representation of their heart, of the way that he actually cares for people. Totally. Like, this does not represent the countless, you know, interactions that we've had and the way that I've watched you, you know, Chris lead. And I don't just say that because he's my boss. Like, Chris will tell you, I have disagreed with him many, many times to the point where he gets sick of it sometimes. But I think that we're really passionate about this because of the Bible and truth, but because of how the truth has played out in our own life.
Yeah.
Like, these truths aren't just, hey, the Bible sounds good. We personally have experienced the reality of, hey, when you do live as if there's no consequences relationally and sexually, there are effects to that.
Side effects.
Side effects. And it doesn't diminish the human, but it does require attention, focus, healing, and work. And so I think it'd be great, Kate, if you shared from that your personal standpoint, because I think it'll give a lot of context as to why we do what we do. It actually isn't, believe it or not, we're not here just to make everybody Christian. We want everybody to be Christian. We love everybody to be in heaven. But really, our goal is to create a really healthy place for people to be whole.
Yeah.
And that comes from our hurt, from the pain that we've experienced, and us all knowing, and Jesus was the solution to this. Mm-hmm. Like, Jesus, crazy. The Bible is real and it applies.
Yeah. As you were sharing the Nehemiah, I was like, oh, I was feeling it up, rise up in my chest. I'm like, that is me. I was the girl who said, why did nobody effing tell me? The first thing I did,
not in my story,
not in her story.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Not in
a girl in another youth group at another time
on the other side of the country. Decade probably.
Yeah.
Are you saying he's old?
Whoa.
Okay. Whoa. Sorry.
You asked that.
Compared to God, I'm young.
No, but for me, when I hear the phrase that is so popular now of toxic purity culture, I get so confused because I'm like, what? Like, I was starving for purity culture. When I got saved, I was very, a shortened version of how I like to say it is, I was the promiscuous party girl who got married to the purity poster boy. So we were,
which I don't want to be the purity poster boy. Just like I'm glad I've lived in purity, but that's not a title I want.
But for real, what happened in my high school and junior high, my story of being this like 12-year-old girl of becoming promiscuous, I only did what the world told me to do. I didn't have somebody sit down and talk to me and give me a vision. My only vision came from the song lyrics we were singing in school, you know, and the movies we were watching. It was so defiled. It was so perverted. It was from the peer pressure of what everybody else is doing. And so I was just on the hamster wheel of, this is what you do. You let guys touch you. You hook up with guys. I found my power from being wanted by guys. And so for me, I'm like, I was so traumatized and so stuck in what was toxic for me that I was starving and yearning for somebody to tell me that there's another way.
Yeah.
That was the first thing I felt like my call and passion to do when I got saved was like, people just need to know there's another way. I did not even think, probably because I didn't think futuristically much at all, but I just was in the moment. And I'm like, this is the way you go. Like, my path that I cared about was about popularity and power. And the way I saw that was in this hookup culture. And I felt like I was winning because I had this long list of guys that I was hooking up with. And my pager was always blowing up. So there's dating me because we didn't have cell phones. I'm a little old too. I had booty calls on my pager and I literally felt like it was like a prize to be won. But really knowing at the end of the day, this is so not fulfilling. There's nothing here.
Well, and then when we got married, it became a challenge. Yeah. You know, she couldn't, it took years. It took a year and a half of counseling and years for her to believe that my love was real.
Yeah. Yeah. The way I say it is like, I've only known lust. It felt impossible to believe love could be real. I'd only known being objectified and being like used.
So I'd put my hand on her back and she would tense up.
Yeah.
And I had never misused her. I had not done the things that these other guys had done. And yet, back to what you said, Chris, these first experiences are so powerful. They actually lay the bedrock and the foundation for our belief. And it's subconscious. It's not even a conscious thought. Right. She didn't consciously think, I can't trust my husband. Her subconscious drew on all these experiences at 7th, 8th, and 9th grade. And then, I mean, it took us years of counseling. It took us years of working through it.
Yeah.
We believe in redemption. She was healed. She was covered. And yet there still was a lot of work, which is why we do what we do. Yeah. Because this is the reality for a lot of people. It isn't so we can make everybody feel like less than Christians. It's actually so we can create powerful spaces for people like Caitlin, who when they're real with themselves and say, this hurt. And I want somewhere that I can admit that this hurts, because you actually can't admit that this hurts in a lot of places, because you're supposed to, I mean, people write songs about how we're not supposed to be emotionally connected to our hookups, and we're not supposed, there's not supposed to be strings attached. And we're, it's like the whole world's trying to convince themselves that this stuff doesn't hurt. And then we get into marriages and marriages aren't able to connect because it actually does. And that's why we've all dedicated our life to this, is to create healthy spaces for people like Kate. Because man, I'm so glad that God has redeemed her. Married for 15 years and I can't wait for the next 100. Actually, I don't want to be that long. Yeah.
I think we have to enter the subject together. And it's really what I see with you know, because I'm a man, obviously it's easy to talk to a man. Daughters need to know how men think.
Yeah.
Like how they're wired sexually. And I understand that's like, oh, you're stereotyping people. It's funny that you can't really have a role model anymore because people are afraid of stereotypes.
Yeah.
And the challenge is that, you know, when you make a comment about people in a broad stroke, it won't, there will always be exceptions.
Always be outliers.
Always be outliers. And not because there's anything wrong with them, but just because God created individuals. But typically speaking, most typically speaking, women are stimulated through touch sexually, and men typically are stimulated through eyes. That's why if you look at porn, yes, women have problems with porn, of course. But if you look percentage-wise, like if you were looking at it as a business, there'd be 80% men, 20% women. And most of that has to do with the way that pornography stimulates people. Mm-hmm. So when we're talking about, you know, like talking to men and women, and we're talking about how do we manage our sexuality in a healthy way? Because the goal isn't to get rid of your sexuality. The goal is to learn how to manage your appetite.
Yeah.
We teach women, hey, this is how men are stimulated. So if you dress a certain way, you're going to stimulate a man this way. This is how guys, this is how women are stimulated. If you inappropriately touch women, you even appropriately, like you can be turning something on that you didn't mean to turn on.
Yeah.
And so it's very difficult to actually have to talk with daughters and sons in a culture that says, no, you're all the same.
You know, I think anytime something like this happens, we want to make sure to be really conscious of the individuals that were hurt while still holding to what we believe to be true.
Totally.
Right. And so I think it's really important. Like, we do believe that it is God's design to wait until you're married to have sex.
We do believe that.
That marriage is between a man and a woman. Like, that's not something that we're going to change our language on, our tone on, our approach on. I think that it's important for people to know, though, we do believe it's each individual single person's responsibility to manage their own sex drive. So for me personally, man, it's my job to guard my thoughts and my eyes. And that's the belief of Bethel. That's the belief of Moral Revolution.
Absolutely.
That's what we believe. I think that's really critical. I also think it's important to that everybody know the context of that story that you shared, because it wasn't this girl that was just being victimized. You actually, for the first time, had a dad looking out for her. And that girl, for the first time in her life, had that. It didn't come across the right way in these videos, but that's the heart of what I know, because I've heard the story a number of times, and that's the reality of it. And I think that's actually more than even just that moment. That's our heart. We want to be fathers to the fatherless and mothers to the motherless. We want to, in this generation, create healthy conversations and clear communication on, hey, this is the best way to live. How do we know? Well, the Bible, and thankfully science is finally catching up and validating everything we've already known. Hey, there is science behind this. And so I think it's just important for everybody to know that. One thing I love about you is that you're willing to do this. A lot of people wouldn't even attempt to create clarity on this kind of stuff. They would get stubborn and obstinate and just say, nope, I think what I think. I've always appreciated that about you, Chris. And I'm not just saying it because the camera's rolling. I do. I'm thankful.
But, you know, we've spent our lives, and this is an area that I've spent a lot of time on. I wrote a book about it. We started Moral Revolution. You guys are our second leadership team in our third leadership team, actually, in Moral Revolution. Yeah. We fund Moral Revolution. So it's an area of passion. So when somebody says, well, you're this, I'm like, oh, I don't care about that. But when they're like, hey, you mistreat women, or you teach people to.
Wait a minute.
I mean, like that, you know, I grew up
far from the truth.
You know, my stepfather's abusing my mother. Like that's a passion of mine. I would never let that happen.
Yeah.
So, you know, so for people to have those kind of ideas about me, like, that's ridiculous. Like it breaks my heart, and it makes me angry to spend your life doing this and having someone say that.
Yeah.
So I think that was my, I asked the team, like, I think I need to make some clarifications, because you're watching a half hour video that should have been an hour and 20 minutes, which I don't know if it would have made it a ton better, but there was a lot of context that people would have had. But also, I think the opportunity to share, hey, this is our passion. And I mean, a lot of people aren't going to like this video, because, you know, there's, we do believe,
just not give them reasons to not like it,
biblical nobility and morality. Yeah. So, you know, but thank you so much for allowing us to come into your home and share with you at least our perspective of what happened.
Yeah, it's great. Appreciate you.
God bless.
Thank you.
Yeah.